So the mission of SR3 is to promote the health and welfare of marine wildlife in the Pacific Northwest. And the vision here is that we can bring the status of the wildlife here back to a point where it can flourish. I think we can all agree it's not flourishing right now, especially if we look at our southern residents or if we look at our sea stars. Things are not going well for those critters. So we're really focusing on that health and welfare component. And our organization is made up of a combination of veterinarians like myself and marine biologists. So what is my background? I am actually, don't tell anyone, but I'm a bird person. So I grew up completely fascinated with birds and with raptors, and spent my childhood doing wildlife rehabilitation work back when children could be involved in such things. They don't allow children to get the rabies vaccine at age 9, like I did. That was my childhood. After I went to vet school, I've been involved in a variety of conservation projects. Spent quite a few months out on that horrible atoll there, doing a rat eradication campaign, actually, to save some endangered shorebirds. I then worked at Lincoln Park Zoo, focusing on rabies eradication and wildlife health in the Serengeti. From there, I came to the Seattle Aquarium, where I was their staff veterinarian for the last 5 years. And then just this last October, we started SR3, which is the new program that we're here to talk about, which really fills a gap in the Pacific Northwest. We'll talk more about what that gap is. But I also work for Sarvey Wildlife Care Center, which is up in Arlington, and that's where I still get my bird fix. So they do amazing work with raptors and other wildlife up there. So who are we? Right now, SR3 has 4 staff, myself, executive director and veterinarian, Casey McLean, who's a veterinary nurse. We have Holly Fernbach, who we'll talk about. And then we just hired Doug Sandilands, who is a marine biologist and disentanglement expert. So his background has been in disentangling large whales from marine debris. And so we're bringing that expertise to Washington so that we can get a program here to do that. So if we have a large whale entangled in Washington, we're going to have a team, a nimble team of people who can go out and disentangle that whale. We also have Andrew here today, who's one of our consultants. That's him with his daughter petting a squirrel. We don't do squirrels, but we do at Sarvey. And then we're lucky to have Laura also as part of our team. Becca. So we've got a really great team of people. And then we're also associated with UW. So I'm faculty at UW as part of the Center for One Health Research, and this program is associated with UW. We also have an amazing board. So we've got people like Joe Gatos, who is part of Sea Doc Society. Show of hands, people who know Sea Doc Society. Yeah, right? They're pretty cool. So they are also part of this and supporting our efforts. And we also have Raven Sky River. If you have not checked out Raven Sky River's work, I know everyone in here loves marine stuff. So if you Google Raven Sky River, he does the most amazing glass work. So definitely check him out. And then we're, of course, collaborative with NOAA, WDFW, and U.S. Fish and Wildlife, because they really direct what we do as an organization. So what we've been up to since we started last October, we have done the first ever sea lion disentanglements in Washington. So it was one of the first things we did. So this is a sedated, not dead, California sea lion. So this is a new technique that we're able to sedate these guys that would be otherwise too dangerous for us to get close to. And then we remove the debris usually around their neck and figure out what it is. So the goal of this program is to disentangle enough animals that we can say for sure what the main causes of entanglements are and then make policy changes so that these things don't get into our oceans. So this guy was disentangled off the coast. We actually spotted him the next day happily grooming and sunning, and I'm sure he's doing well. So you know those white packing straps? People always ask, well, how does that get out there? And it's actually a byproduct of the fishing industry. Packing straps are wrapped around bait boxes like herring. So what happens is when they're baiting the lines, the packing strap just goes. We want to be able to show if that's the most common form of entanglement here. It'll add a lot of momentum to the Lose the Loop campaign, where we're trying to make these biodegradable so that they fall off, because they're such strong material that they stay on their necks, and unfortunately it's not a good outcome for these animals. Plus it's incredibly painful, right? So these actually dig into their neck. But we disentangled 2 animals that had packing straps on their neck. And this was collaborative with actually Vancouver Aquarium Marine Science Center. And that's Joe Gatos from Sea Doc Society. And you can't tell that's me because I'm dressed up like a little Yeti, but I was really cold. So it was a very cold day. But yeah, we're really happy to be kind of spearheading that program here in Washington and freeing these guys from these entanglements. Any questions about that before I move on to talking about killer whales? This is everyone's favorite. And I have to preface this with, my expertise is more pinnipeds and sea otters, but we have a wonderful killer whale expert who's right now in Antarctica, and so I'm speaking on her behalf. So if I can't answer your question, I'll ask her and she'll get back to you. So these guys, southern resident killer whales, are the largest members actually of the dolphin family, and they get their name actually because they kill whales. So that's kind of an interesting thing. I actually have, for someone in the audience, who can answer this question. So can anyone here give me three other names for a killer whale? Three at once. Yep. That's yes. Okay. Scientific name. But do you know other? That's amazing. it's the youngest member here who knows their scientific name. There's a couple other names that they get that are kind of unusual. We're really close. Blackfish is one. One starts with an O, and I think everyone said it. There's one more that's a really odd one. If anyone gets it, they're going to get this hat. Yes, but you sorry, Grampus. Killer whales are their kind of preferred scientific name. So it's like saying starfish versus sea stars, right? We prefer to say sea stars, but let's all be honest, it's totally fine to say starfish, and no one should get their wrist slapped for that. Other names, orcas, grampus, blackfish. Everything comes in threes with these guys. There's three ecotypes, three resident populations, and then of course, down here, the famous ones are the three pods that are popular, that live down here, J, K, and L. And then they're also worldwide. So these guys live kind of everywhere. They're very successful at adapting to a variety of different ecosystems. Holly, who's down in Antarctica right now, has gotten some amazing pictures of animals down there that have that lighter color. So it's kind of cool, the variations. Unfortunately, though, as of December of this last year, the SRKW population is down to 78. So that's pretty low. That's one of the lowest it's ever been. Last year we lost 6 individuals. One was a boat strike. One was, we're not sure. This is a sad image of the calf. It had a bunch of rake marks and stuff on it as the adults were trying to keep it up, they suspect, as it got very weak. So it was a really rough year for the southern residents. And I meant to mention in the slide prior, as far as like the kind of the go-to for information on SRKWs, I highly recommend the Center for Whale Research. So if you haven't checked out their website, definitely do that. Whale Scout also has amazing information on their website. So what are we doing? So Holly Fernbach has pioneered with several collaborators the drone method of collecting respiratory secretions so we can get more information about the health of the animals. But also a really important thing that she's doing is looking at the animals from above to get their body condition. So I know that might seem weird, but it's a way for us to non-invasively figure out, like, are they fat? Are they skinny? How is their calf growing? And so this photogrammetry allows us to take the picture from a certain height consistently and then be able to figure out the weight of the animal. And so that's a really cool thing to be able to do, because otherwise there's no way, just looking at the dorsal fin, you know, from the side, that we'd be able to figure out how the animals are doing. So this is really groundbreaking research that helps us figure out how the pods are doing in relation to the fish numbers, other stressors in the environment. So this is just more pictures kind of the hexacopter, and also of an example of the same animal when it's both skinny from above and then when it's doing well. And so you can really tell the difference for these guys. It's not hard. They use a mathematical program and computers to actually do the calculations and figure out the body weight, but you can just see from the pictures. People always ask, well, what's causing the SRKW decline? It's likely very multifactorial, but of course salmon, which is a big topic here, is very important. They are a specialist predator, only eating certain types of salmonids, and so with endangered salmon populations, it's not surprising that these guys are endangered too. But we also have issues, you know, with noise, with toxins, and with a lot of other things going on. So there's a lot of different challenges that these guys are facing, and we're trying to figure out what is the most important thing we can do to help them get through this and start to recover instead of continuing this decline. SR3 is also starting to increase our study of whales in the Salish Sea, because I mentioned, you know, humpbacks are here now. They haven't been here before. So we need to figure out, like, what types, like, what ages are these all? Juveniles coming into the Salish Sea, adults? Do they have entanglement scars? How are they doing? How's their body condition score? So we're going to start this year really expanding the whale health program in the area to figure out what's going on. And then, as I mentioned, we've hired Doug Sandiland. So he's coming in to start our disentanglement program in the area. This is a picture of a humpback whale that Doug disentangled on the East Coast. And this humpback is actually what we call hogtied. This is a really severe entanglement that goes through his mouth and then wraps around his flukes. And so he wasn't even really able to surface fully and swim normally. And actually, Doug, it took 3 days. These efforts are really intensive. They had to follow the animal, figure out what was going on, and then make the strategic cuts, because you don't have multiple approaches to these guys, and you don't want to stress them out too much. So it's a very time-intensive and very strategic thing to do, and it takes years to learn how to do this. So we're really lucky to have him out here. So that's kind of, in a nutshell, what's going on with our program in relation to whales and whale health in the region, both disentanglement and SRKWs. Before I switch into kind of the rehab side of things, do you guys have any questions about those topics? Last year we had quite a few calls about a gray whale that people thought was sick, and it was actually just normal foraging behavior. So that's just a cool thing to note, is that they do go down usually on their left side and put their one fin in the air, and it looks really weird. I mean, it looks like they're trying to beach or something, because they're usually in shallow water. But it's just them filter feeding, and they usually are sided and go to one side all the time. So it's kind of cool to watch. So we think that they get caught in abnormal currents or normal currents, and they're kind of like jellyfish, in that they don't have their own kind of propulsion. They use the currents to go. I mean, they can swim, right? But they use currents to forage. And so abnormal currents, we've had a lot of weird warm water on the California coast. We've also had a lot of harmful algal blooms. So whether their navigation systems are interfered with because of toxins, we don't know for sure. But I think last year we had 12, not this year, but the year before in the winter, we had 12 wash up in this area, some live, some dead. And it's an increasing issue in this area. Yeah, but they are definitely cold and not happy to be here. So we've got Bob Keel in the audience. He helped with sea turtle rehabilitation. Okay. Yep, at Seattle Aquarium. Bob spent many hours helping with that, doing the life support. So a lot of people in here have been touched by the sea turtles up here. Tucker's gonna be released. So it's been a slow recovery. Everything with reptiles is very slow, but Tucker's doing really well now. So he's gonna be released this summer. So for those of you Tucker followers. Not the orcas necessarily, but maybe indirectly they could be, but they're not competing for the same, they're not eating the salmon that the southern residents are eating. And but they're eating other sources of food down here that they could be competing with other animals down here, like the pinnipeds. But that's a good question. Yeah, that's a really good question. That actually brings me to another thing that you may have seen in the news lately. There was a paper published about how many salmon harbor seals are eating. Has anyone seen that? More salmon? Yeah. So there was a mathematical study done. It's really a great study showing that harbor seals likely are eating, in certain years, 1.4 million pounds of Chinook, juveniles mostly, whereas the southern residents eat about 1.2 million pounds per year. And so the concern is, like, are these guys eating so much salmon that it's actually inhibiting the recovery of the southern residents? And so I actually had a long conversation with one of the authors of that paper about, okay, what are your thoughts here? And his kind of take on this whole issue is that they have shown that the harbor seals and the sea lions eat a ton of salmon in years where the typical forage fish like herring and anchovies are not available. And so this is really kind of an indication of this disruption in the food web, right? Salmon are dying because of harbor seals eating them, but it's an indirect cause. The direct cause is the forage fish populations crashing. And so there's been a lot of work looking at forage fish, but we still don't know the exact cause of why the forage fish populations have plummeted so much. Habitat degradation and commercial fisheries are kind of top concerns, but we don't actually have the answer yet. So a good thing to keep in mind, especially for you harbor seal lovers out there, if someone is like, oh, we need to take care of those harbor seals, you need to get rid of them because they're competing with the orcas for food, just remind them they're a native species, important part of the food web, and we shouldn't try to reduce their numbers to protect the salmon, because that could cause other things that could actually cause the salmon to go down even more. So we want to keep our native wildlife. We have a link to it on our website, on our Facebook, but it was published in a Canadian journal. But yeah, if you look on our... Yeah, it's a really great research paper. So it's a really well-done, peer-reviewed publication. And, you know, it was great that they did this, because people have often speculated, well, how much salmon do these guys actually eat? So it was cool to actually get kind of a number estimate. Of course, it's an estimate, so it's based on, you know, a bunch of mathematical modeling, but it's really well done. So they do eat a lot in years where other fish aren't available. But when the fish is available, they don't. So, Yeah, an important reason to focus on forage fish recovery. This map really brings me to why SR3 was created. In all of the other regions in North America, there are facilities or centers dedicated to caring for stranded or injured marine wildlife. So Washington and Oregon are unique in that we don't have a facility like that. And so SR3 was created to really fill that gap. In British Columbia, Alaska, California, all along the East Coast, there are centers that will respond to these stranded or injured marine animals and have dedicated hospitals and rehabilitation facilities that are coupled with science centers that help us understand what's going on. So that is actually one of the main reasons that we exist, is to help fill that gap up here and help people like Robin deal with stranded seals. So right now, PAWS is an amazing facility, a wildlife rehabilitation facility, and they are wonderful in that they take quite a few harbor seal pups every year. Their capacity is around 6 animals per year, and just to give you a reference for how many seals per year just north of us are rehabbed, so the Marine Mammal Rescue Center at Vancouver Aquarium does anywhere between 150 and 200 harbor seal pups a year. So, you know, six, like, poor PAWS is always being like, hey, can you take more? Can you take more? And they get full very early in the year, and we're not able to respond to a lot of other strandings. They also can't take adult pinnipeds, adult sea lions or seals, harbor porpoise, and a lot of other species that strand here, or sea turtles. So we're really trying to fill a niche to be able to respond to all these other critters. Right now, one of the things we do is, if it's an endangered critter like a Guadalupe fur seal, we'll stabilize it up here, and then we'll actually ship it down to California. We can do better, and that's why we're here. So a lot of people ask, why is wildlife rehabilitation important? Especially with harbor seals, right? Because harbor seals are at their carrying capacity, so why should we rehabilitate them? Wildlife rehabilitation is only done for the purpose of surveillance and teaching and all these other reasons. It's not usually done to maintain the population levels unless it's an endangered species. And then yes, rehabilitation is, like with the Hawaiian monk seals, incredibly important for the population because there's so few animals left. But human interactions, intentional and not, are common issues. So unfortunately, it's more common than you guys would probably like to know how many animals are shot. At the Wildlife Rehabilitation Center that I work at, SARVI, roughly 30 to 40% of our patients are actually gunshot. So it's a really common issue, even in the Seattle area. But then monitoring ocean health, these guys give us a window onto ocean health that we otherwise wouldn't have. Rehabilitating these guys is like hooking up a monitor to the ocean to figure out what's going on. It also helps us build knowledge. So for this is Tucker in the hyperbaric chamber. We learned a lot about sea turtles and their physiology just through that one case. Helps train future generations of both biologists and veterinarians. And it also promotes that coexistence piece, which is so important. Because I hope that by the time I retire, we're not seeing 30 to 40% of the animals coming through these centers being gunshot cases. And that really comes down to helping people understand the interaction between wildlife and their livelihood. Gunshot cases are usually probably the result of people thinking that bald eagle is gonna take their cat or their poultry or other issues. So kind of informing people about their important role in the environment. I have another question. Let's see if I have more stuff to give away, of course. Can anyone tell me what that is? Oh, nice, vaquita, yes. How am I supposed to give away that many things? So there's only 30 vaquita left. And so I wanted to talk about this picture was here to remind me of the question of, we also get the question a lot of, are you going to take animals from the rehabilitation center that are not releasable and put them under human care and captive institutions? And ultimately, that's not SR3's kind of decision. We're leaving that to NOAA and other partners, but we're definitely not against it. And I wanted to use this example, not because we want to take vaquitas in to do a captive breeding program, but because one of the ways that we've been able to track vaquita is by studying harbor porpoise that are actually under human care at the Vancouver Aquarium. And so having animals under human care allows us to do amazing conservation research. And this guy is just an example, because we wouldn't be able to track these guys and find them without working with those harbor porpoise. So there's definitely some conservation ties to having these critters in those type of roles. So I just wanted to mention that. Any questions about that or wildlife rehabilitation in general? What are you going to say when someone asks you, why would you rehabilitate a harbor seal? You tell them there's so many reasons. So who needs rehab in Washington? This cutie, that cutie, that cutie, that cutie. Lots of amazing animals need rehabilitation here. And it all goes to serve science, teaching, and a better understanding of our marine health in the Pacific Northwest. That's a fur seal, which is one of my favorite species. We're also going to be helping birds, seabirds, shorebirds, because again, I'm a bird person, so we won't just be focusing on mammals. But there's a lot of different species here that need that. So next steps for us, we're in the process of fundraising for a mobile hospital or just an ambulance so we can go out to the beaches, respond to these injured animals, get them into a safe space where we can do a health assessment, figure out whether they're candidates for rehabilitation. We're also going to have kind of an autopsy unit where if these animals aren't really good candidates for rehabilitation, we can do a complete autopsy and figure out why they stranded in the first place, which helps us learn so much about ocean health. So it's a really important thing to do. We're also in the process of creating a small rehabilitation facility, kind of a short-term facility, that can hopefully open this spring and summer to respond to animals while we focus on building a larger facility that would open in the next 3 to 5 years. So we hope to have that open soon. And then we're trying to build capacity for the southern resident killer whale work that Holly does by acquiring a new vessel that will support that work, but will also support the disentanglement efforts. So those are our big pushes for this year that we're trying to accomplish. And everyone asks how you can help. There's so many different ways. You guys are already involved in so many nonprofits, a lot of you guys here. So, you know, keep doing what you're doing. SR3 will be taking volunteers too. Spread the word. A lot of people don't know there's only 78 southern resident killer whales left. So spread the word, get that out there. And then, you know, if it's something you want to donate towards, donate. So we really appreciate all support though. Time for more questions. Does anyone else have questions? Great question. Why doesn't the aquarium have a hospital for stuff like this? So the aquarium is very space limited on those piers. And their mission is really focused on inspiring conservation of the marine environment and kind of educating children. And they're an amazing institution, but this is not, you know, kind of their mission or what they want to do, and they don't have the space to do it. And so, you know, it really requires a separate organization to come in. But, you know, they have an amazing platform for education. They get almost 1 million visitors every year and do a great job of telling the story about what's important in the marine environment. So we'll be collaborating with them to kind of tell those stories and collaborate on research as well. Great question about oil spills. So what would our role be and how would we work together in an oil spill event for marine animals? Yeah, so right now there's very limited capacity to respond for marine animals. And so we are going to be helping kind of coordinate that response in this state. So one of our board members is Dr. Michael Zaccardi, who is the president of the Oil Wildlife Care Network down in California that kind of oversees oil wildlife response in the whole country. And so he's going to be helping us work together with local orgs to develop plans for responding to critters up here. And then one of our pieces of the puzzle will be actually the response capacity. So both responders for the animals, but then the tanks and everything to rehab the animals in. So we're working on finalizing the location right now. So we're working on an LOI and a lease, and we're going to be in the Seattle area, but our exact location will be announced hopefully in the next month or two. But we will be in the Seattle area because we're collaborative with UW. We want something that's accessible for students at UW, but also accessible for the animals. And so we will be in this area. We'll keep you posted.
We'll be in West Seattle.
Maybe not. It may not be in West Seattle. We were kind of pushing towards that, but unfortunately that probably isn't going to work out. But I'll keep you posted. It might. If it's not, it'll be close enough that we'll be able to transport animals really easily from West Seattle. It takes time. This, as a veterinarian, I've learned so much about permitting and, you know, all the different pieces of this puzzle. So, but we have been working with the port previously, and we're going to continue to work with a bunch of different players to figure out where, but it might be. So like Andrew said, if you own 2 acres of waterfront property, let us know. But yeah, so we've got a couple sites that are looking good. But we'll see kind of what finally shakes down. But the only promise I can make now is that it's going to be in Seattle. Yeah, so we'll probably have a couple vessels, and we'll moor it, you know, at any facility that has a. There's quite a few different areas where you can purchase a slip, like on an annual basis. So, you know, the closer to the facility, the better. But it doesn't have to be right at the facility. Right now, we have an angel donor who has helped us get off the ground and operational. But we're really, you know, needing to be a community-supported organization. So, you know, a broad donor base, and, you know, we're applying for a lot of grants. So far, we've had one major angel donor and a couple other donors that have come in to support us. Robin asked tough questions. So the question was, how many seal pups will you be able to accommodate? So we're planning for, you know, quite a few, But in this first year, NOAA will not be modifying its rehabilitation policy and will be capping it at 25 animals for this first year. And then we'll just, you know, assess it on a scientific basis annually and figure out what is a good number for this region. So NOAA is the agency that really oversees marine mammals, most marine mammals except like sea otters and some others. And so their rehab policy is regional. And so for this region, it really depends on the situation. If the animal has had a human interaction, like a dog bite wound or something, it's always going to be a candidate for rehabilitation unless we don't have space. And we've run into that quite a bit. But it really depends. So the idea of letting nature take its course is something that's promoted with certain critters. Everything we do is under NOAA. So SR3, and that's why I said, as far as the, when animals go from rehabilitation centers to zoos or aquariums, that's really a decision that's made by larger agencies and places like the Marine Mammal Center and other large successful rehabilitation centers do place certain animals under human care, but it's not done frequently. So if there's not room, do they just die? Unfortunately, yes. Either they die or they're euthanized. And so that was actually one of the reasons that SR3 started, was that we didn't want to keep having to euthanize animals, and we wanted to be able to offer them a health examination and an opportunity to be rehabilitated if that's the right decision for the animal. And in cases where it's not, we're going to perform a complete autopsy or necropsy so that we can figure out what may have happened and also get baseline information on the health of that critter and ocean health. We get a lot of information also from live sampling of animals, like blood draws and swabs and all that stuff from live critters and rehabilitation as well. Good question, though. Sad part of this. All of Washington, and will help out Oregon when they need it. So Oregon is also working on developing a center like this, but they anticipate it's going to be a few years behind SR3. And so we'll be working to cover Oregon coastline when they've got an endangered critter that needs rehab or when they have a situation where they want help. So we're very collaborative with folks down at Oregon Coast Aquarium and OSU. We've helped them get a disentanglement program off the ground down there, and we work very closely with them. So yeah, we'll cover. And so this area, Washington, has as much coastline as California. So it's a lot of coastline. So if you want to volunteer, get involved. Yeah, that's a great question, though. The question is, what is the success rate for stranded cetaceans? So it really depends on the age and the reason for stranding. Harbor porpoise, though, are very rehabable when you have the right tools. So up at Vancouver Aquarium Marine Science Center, they've kind of figured out what is important in a harbor porpoise rehab process. And one of them is stress. So giving these guys some medications that help reduce their stress right away is an important thing to help the long-term success. And that applies to shorebirds as well. So shorebirds are very sensitive to rehabilitation. But if you give them things like midazolam or valium, they do way better. And the same thing applies for harbor porpoise. So being able to give them a little bit of happy drugs so that they're not so stressed about the fact that they're surrounded by aliens who they think want to eat them, then they do way better. But yeah, they're very rehabable. And but each case will be assessed on a case-by-case basis. If they're really emaciated, they've got big wounds, it's just wildlife rehab in general, we always take the case and the animal welfare into account as our primary concern. So if we think the animal's in a lot of pain that we can't control, then euthanasia is always the best option because we don't want to have an animal suffering. That's my primary thing as a veterinarian, is to prevent suffering, not necessarily to save lives. And I know sometimes that's hard to accept, but that's our goal. But great question. But harbor porpoise are a big priority for us. So we've designed our largest tank really around harbor porpoise and stellar sea lions as our priority species. Everything. Education, hands-on, animal response stuff. So there's a lot of volunteer opportunities. And when we have an active rehabilitation center, we need so many volunteers to help prep food, feed animals, clean tanks. It's a lot of work. Anyone who's done animal rehabilitation knows how much work it is. And it's grunt work, and it's hard work, and a lot of animals die because that's wildlife rehabilitation. But when you go to a release where you take an animal that came in injured and you release it, there's nothing better. So it'll all pay itself off when you can do that. So that's the reward. So there's some changes in the long lining industry here in Washington. We don't know exactly what's going to happen, but we've reduced our long lining here, and we're to try to actually reduce bycatch. So for seabirds and stuff, which long lining can be quite detrimental for, but it has likely resulted in the use of more fisheries that use ropes. So those are the ones that humpbacks and other whales get entangled in. And so we're not sure what changes are going to happen, but we're glad we have dug because we may see more entanglements in the region. And SR3 will be out there monitoring, doing active surveillance, and building capacity to respond to these guys. And so the question is, will the permanent facility be open to the public? Yes, for sure. So we'll have a way for people to come in, learn about marine conservation. We'll have a way for people to see the critters under rehab that the critters aren't stressed by. So probably like a one-way mirror type situation where the animals won't even know you're there. But you'll be able to see the animals under rehabilitation. So that is the ultimate goal. I think that's really where the magic happens, and you can inspire people to care about this kind of stuff, is to see these animals that came in, you know, whether it was a ship strike or a boat, you know, or a dog bite or a gunshot, and see them under rehab, be able to tell their story, why they're there, and then just be able to show people them going back out. So really great question, though. So the question is, will you guys be involved in kind of the enforcement side of things, like seeing where vessels are getting too close to whales? Yeah, or yeah. So, you know, we'll do our part to report things, and we'll encourage people to report things. So on our website, we've got the hotline to call if you see someone harassing a marine mammal or is too close to a marine mammal, to call that in immediately. And so we, you know, anytime we're out and we see something like that, we will definitely, you know, call it in. So that's an important piece. You see people getting too close to these animals. We really want to give them a safe distance, not only because it's required by the Marine Mammal Protection Act, but for their health and safety. So really good point about that. Yeah, and it doesn't just apply to the whales, but also the sea lions and the whole message about share the shore. So the beaches, you know, the pinnipeds, the seals, and the sea lions use those beaches. It's a natural behavior, and so keeping your pets and your children away from those animals is really important. So awesome to see all you guys. Thank you so much for coming out tonight. We appreciate it, and feel free to check out all the information. And